China is doing something that doesn't seem to make sense. It's building more coal power plants than any other country, yet at the same time, it's installing as much solar, wind, and nuclear capacity as the rest of the world combined. Its CO2-emitting blast furnaces produce more steel than the next 10 countries combined, but it's also rolling out 6,000 electric vehicles every single day. So, what's really going on? Is China leading the clean energy transition, or is it locking in decades more fossil fuels? The answer is both, and at a scale no other country can match. But why? And what does this mean for the rest of the world? In this video, we'll break down China's dominance across nearly every energy sector, from coal to renewables to electric vehicles. We'll look at the forces driving its energy decisions, compare its progress to the rest of the world, and ask whether its approach is replicable or even sustainable. I'm Rosie Barnes, founder of Padalot Consulting, where we advise on clean energy technologies, helping startups with development and investors with assessing the landscape. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. If you only looked at one side of China's energy story, it would be easy to assume the country is locking itself into a fossil fuel future. In 2023 alone, China added 47 gigawatts of new coal capacity. That's more than the total coal fleet of Germany and Japan combined. It still accounts for around two-thirds of all new coal power being built globally, and China still generates 60% of its electricity from coal, which is one of the main reasons why it is currently the world's largest emitter of greenhouse gases. But here's the paradox. Despite all these new plants, China's coal fleet is running at record low utilization rates. In 2023, they averaged just 51% capacity, meaning nearly half of their generating potential is sitting idle. Compare that to the early 2000s, when China's coal fleet regularly operated at 70% or higher. So if these coal plants aren't being used to their full potential, why is China still building them? A partial answer lies in grid stability. Unlike most other grids, which rely on gas peakers and increasingly batteries to fill gaps in renewable generation, China is using coal to provide flexible backup. Many of its coal plants have been retrofitted or upgraded to act as peakers, ramping up and down fast as needed. Another reason is provincial politics. Local governments approve coal projects to stimulate local economies, even at a loss. According to a 2022 CREA report, many plants are approved with little regard for long-term energy needs, leading to overcapacity and financial inefficiency. But why keep building coal just as its use is peaking? After all, analysts predict China's coal consumption will likely peak this year as renewables and nuclear expand. Some see this as a mistake, locking in emissions and stranded assets. Others view it as an energy security measure. But while coal plants continue to be built, the real shift is already happening elsewhere. Between 2018 and 2023, China more than tripled solar generation, doubled bioenergy, and increased wind by 2.5 times. Nuclear grew by 50%, and even hydropower rose 4%. Coal is no longer really the backbone of China's energy system. It's becoming a backup to an increasingly renewable grid. To understand how China is pulling off this transition, we need to look at its unparalleled investment in solar, wind, and hydropower, the real forces shaping the country's long-term energy strategy. But before we go any further, let's talk about something important. The way energy and climate stories are reported in the media can vary greatly depending on the source. Some highlight China as a leader in clean energy, while others focus on its coal dependency. It's the same data, but different conclusions. That's why I've been using Ground News, the sponsor of today's video. Ground News is an app and website that brings together news stories from all over and shows you the context. You can see the political bias, check the factuality of sources, and compare how different outlets report the same event. It helps you cut through media narratives and think critically about news. Take a look at this story. Coal demand to continue hitting records through 2027, IEA says. Ground News found 112 sources covering this story, and the reporting differences are striking. Left-leaning sources say 2024 is the hottest year on record, framing it as a climate crisis. Meanwhile, right-leaning sources focus on the irony of rising fossil fuel use, questioning global climate policies. Another feature I love is the blind spot feed, which highlights stories heavily covered by one side of the political spectrum, but barely mentioned on the other. This is great for making sure you're not missing out on important events just because your usual news sources aren't covering them. I highly recommend subscribing to Ground News to support an independent platform that makes it easier to understand current events. You can save 40% on the unlimited access Vantage plan I use by heading to ground.news/Rosie or scanning the QR code on the screen. When it comes to renewables, China isn't just leading the pack, it is redefining the global energy landscape. China is the clear leader in hydropower with about 29% of the world's total, thanks to projects like the Three Gorges Dam, the world's largest power station by installed capacity. And China continues to build hydro. Recently, China has been responsible for nearly 75% of new global hydropower capacity, including pumped hydro storage projects. These are essential for balancing the grid as more solar and wind power are integrated. China's solar expansion is nothing short of breathtaking. In 2024, the country installed 277 gigawatts of new capacity. This takes them up to nearly 900 gigawatts in total, as much as the rest of the world combined. A major driver of this growth is a rise of distributed solar, which now makes up 41% of China's total. Almost half of that came from household installations, boosted by China's whole country solar model, which encourages entire counties to adopt solar power at scale to accelerate growth at the local level. And on the complete opposite end of the scale, China is home to the world's largest solar farm. In fact, China is home to the 9 largest solar farms in the world. And that's just the mainstream solar techs. China also recently connected the world's first gigawatt-scale floating solar farm, and they are building other solar projects like concentrated solar power and amongst the leaders in perovskite solar cell manufacturing. So basically, all the solar techs for China. Now let's turn to wind. China is nearly as globally dominant in wind power as it is in solar, with total capacity exceeding 440 gigawatts at the end of 2023, equivalent to the combined wind capacity of the next 12 leading countries, or 43% of the global total. Similar for solar, China has the world's largest wind farm. And while onshore wind dominates, offshore wind is where China is truly pushing boundaries. China's offshore wind capacity exceeds Europe's entire offshore fleet and is growing far faster than anywhere else in the world, with 2/3 of the world's offshore wind installed in 2023 in China. While China's renewable energy boom often steals the spotlight, its nuclear sector is also expanding at a pace unmatched by any other country. China connected its first nuclear power plant to the grid in 1991, and by 2023, this has expanded to 55 nuclear reactors, contributing roughly 5% of the country's electricity generation. That is smaller than each of solar, wind, and hydro, but China is adding nuclear capacity faster than any other nation is. By 2035, China plans to surpass the United States to become the world's largest nuclear power producer. Though, it has to be said that while China has been hitting its renewable energy targets early, with its wind and solar 2030 targets achieved already by 2024, it has been lagging behind its planned progress in nuclear. It still hasn't reached its 2020 target for nuclear of 58 gigawatts, so I guess take their goals with a grain of salt. So that is China's electricity generation, still very coal-dominated today, but all of the momentum is now solidly behind clean energy sources, with those growing extraordinarily fast. All of this new electricity supply going in all over the country raises another couple of points. What are they doing with all that electricity, and how are they getting it from where it's generated to where it's used? And it turns out that this is just a couple more examples of China dominating the energy transition. Let's look at transport. China is the world's largest market for electric vehicle adoption. In 2023, nearly 14 million electric cars were sold globally, and China accounted for 8.1 million of those, over 60% of the global total. Within China, EVs made up nearly 40% of all new passenger vehicle sales, a number that continues to rise. While some countries, like Norway, have a higher share of EVs among new car sales, China leads by far in absolute numbers and infrastructure expansion. China also has the largest electrified rail network, and it's still growing fast. Its heavy vehicle fleet is also electrifying faster than other countries, with far more electric trucks and buses sold in China than everywhere else combined. To support its rapid electrification, China has built the world's most advanced ultra-high voltage direct current UHVDC transmission network. These power lines transport massive amounts of renewable energy from remote regions to urban centers, reducing transmission losses, and they will eventually enable a nationwide renewable energy grid. There are currently about 40,000 kilometers of UHVDC in the world, and 80% of that is in China. As well as building enormous amounts of transmission to get renewable electricity to where it's needed, as China expands its variable renewable generation, it also needs more energy storage to get electricity when it's needed. China has more grid-scale batteries installed than any other country, more hydrogen electrolyzers actually being installed and not just talked about, the biggest flow batteries, the first large-scale gravity energy storage systems, they're also installing compressed air energy storage, sodium ion batteries, flywheels, superconductors. Energy storage, even more than the others, really feels like China is taking a kitchen sink approach, installing basically any storage tech that anyone has ever sketched on the back of a napkin, and including definite game changers, along with quite a few that make me wonder, what on earth are they thinking? So basically, I've just listed a series of energy technologies and noted that China is dominating the global rollout of every single one. There are actually a few that they're not dominating, but it really is just a few. The UK are leading in tidal and wave energy, for example, though China is still dabbling in those. And China hasn't made a whole lot of progress in decarbonizing industry like green steel and cement. Overwhelmingly, though, the story is one of China's clean tech leadership. I'm sure you're aware of this. I am, of course, by no means the first to describe China's energy transition as unprecedented in scale and speed. But then you might be thinking, China is a huge country, so perhaps it should be expected they would lead everything. Is its success solely due to its size? Or are there other factors at play? Let's break it down. China's size does give it a significant advantage. It's got the second largest economy after the United States, the second largest population after India, and the third largest landmass after Russia and Canada, or fourth if you include Antarctica. So the country has both the demand and the resources to deploy energy technologies at a massive scale, but not the largest. So size alone really can't explain why China is outpacing the rest of the world. Centralized planning and aggressive targets are one of the drivers of China's energy transition, while other countries in the EU and the US and here in Australia debate policies and struggle with bureaucratic hurdles. China is a lot more free to focus on execution at scale. Another factor that sets China apart is its ability to start from a clean slate in many areas. For example, in remote regions where UHVDC lines are being installed, there was often no existing electricity grid to begin with. This allows China to design and build state-of-the-art infrastructure from scratch, tailored to the needs of a modern renewable heavy energy mix. Similarly, many of the EVs sold in China are bought by people who have never owned a car before. For these buyers, the choice isn't between a petrol-powered car or an electric one. It's between no car at all or an electric one. In contrast, developed countries face a more complex challenge. Transitioning to a low-carbon energy system often requires either waiting for old infrastructure to reach the end of its life, which can slow the pace of change, or replacing functioning systems prematurely, which can be prohibitively expensive. China's energy transition provides important insights globally. Its achievements in renewables and nuclear installation, EV adoption, and UHVDC network development highlight the advantages that you can get from having ambitious goals and state-led investment. But China's approach also has its flaws. Overcapacity in sectors like coal power and solar manufacturing has led to inefficiencies and financial losses. Provincial governments, eager to boost local economies, seem to have approved projects with little regard for long-term energy needs or environmental impacts. In the early years of China's wind industry, many turbines were built before it was possible to connect them to the grid, resulting in sometimes really long delays before they could contribute meaningful power. It's somewhat similar to the ghost cities that China's over-enthusiastic property industry built. This highlights a broader pattern in China's energy transition, an emphasis on rapid construction over efficient integration. From a Western point of view, the approach of prioritizing deployment first and working out the details later has led to wasted resources, something that would be politically untenable in most Western democracies, where governments are commonly voted out if they preside over wasteful spending of public money. But it's possible to view it differently, as China's willingness to be wasteful in the early days of their wind industry has eventually led them to become world leaders at making and installing wind turbines. So is China's energy transition a model for the world, or a unique case that can't be replicated? Or perhaps even an economic collapse waiting to happen? The reality is that developed countries can't simply copy China's approach. The scale, governance structure, and economic drivers behind China's energy transformation are distinct. Countries with smaller, market-driven economies, entrenched fossil fuel infrastructure, and slower approval processes can simply not match China's pace. But it's also obviously not something that could be ignored. China's rapid electrification is already totally changing global energy markets. The country's fast adoption of electric vehicles and its massive expansion of renewable energy capacity are driving down global costs and reducing global oil consumption. This trend is expected to continue, and China is likely to become the most electrified major economy by 2030. Rather than attempting to replicate China's model, I think that other countries may need to accept that to a large extent, they're just along for the ride, needing to adjust to the shifts that China creates in energy markets, supply chains, and technology costs. This means adapting strategies, taking advantage of China's innovations, and finding space for our own. Thanks to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team, who not only contribute financial support, but also suggest future topics and discuss energy technologies on our exclusive Discord server. You can join us at this link. We'd love to have you join. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.